Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Bloomberg. Very quickly, for logistic reasons, the session today will be in English and French. So you have headsets on the table. Please use it. Press one for English and two for French. And I'm going to say that now again in French. Bonjour, mesdames et messieurs. Bienvenue à Bloomberg. Vous avez sur la table des microphones que vous pouvez utiliser car la session aujourd'hui sera en anglais et en français. Appuyez sur le 1 pour l'anglais et appuyez sur 2 pour la traduction en français. Je vous remercie beaucoup. Thank you very much. I'm going to now ask our chairman, Mr. Peter Grauer, to come for the welcome address. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was a very early morning set of applause. So it was very subdued, but very distinguished, appropriate for this group. Thank you all for being here. I'm Peter Grauer, the executive chairman of Bloomberg. And as you can imagine, we are very excited to be co-hosting this event with BRVM today. We've assembled some great speakers and great panels for a number of topics that are both timely and relevant to all of us. As you may know, Bloomberg is the leading provider of financial and business information globally, and we're committed to bringing transparency to the capital markets in all countries in which we operate. We work with over 360 exchanges globally, including 15 in Africa, giving access to real-time pricing feeds for our clients. But in addition to our client relationships, we work closely with central banks in the region and host the sovereign bond auction for Botswana, the tender system for the South Africa Reserve Bank. Last year in Nigeria and most recently in Ghana, we've won the right to host the fixed income secondary market flow, making Bloomberg's electronic bond trading platform the platform of choice. We have 9 offices on the continent, more than 200 employees across sales, news, data, and research, numbers that have been rising dramatically over the last 2 years. And in the last 5 years, the number of our installed Bloomberg terminals on the continent has grown from roughly 1,650 to about 3,500 terminals. And just parenthetically, we see Africa, the African continent, and the economic and financial opportunities that you represent to be one of the key long-term growth areas and very much part of our long-term strategy going forward. In August of 2014, we were very thrilled to co-host with the White House and the Department of Commerce the first ever U.S.-Africa Business Forum that took place in Washington, D.C., with more than 50 African leaders and over 300 U.S. and African chief executive officers in attendance. And as a follow-up to that, I've been working closely with the Obama administration as a member of the President's Advisory Council for Doing Business in Africa, which is a group of 15 private sector leaders that advise President Obama on strengthening the commercial engagement between the U.S. and Africa and attracting foreign investment to the continent. As a member of the Investment and Access to Capital Subcommittee, last spring, I presented the leading recommendation to make capital markets in Africa more robust through technical assistance and capacity building. As home to some of the fastest growing economies in the world, it is clearly an exciting time for Africa, and we look forward to some very lively discussions and exchanges of ideas today as you engage in this conference. With that, I'd like to turn it over to Mr. Pierre Atepa Gudiabi, I didn't get that right, I'm sure, the chairman of the board of directors of BRVM, to say a few words. Pierre.
Good morning, everybody. Excellence, Monsieur Lionel Zinsou, Premier ministre de la République du Bénin, Excellence Monsieur Charles Kofi Dibi, ministre d'État, ministre des Affaires étrangères de la République de Côte d'Ivoire, Monsieur le Président de Bloomberg, Monsieur le directeur général de la Bourse régionale des valeurs, Excellences, Messieurs les ambassadeurs, Mesdames, Messieurs les présidents directeurs généraux des sociétés cotées, sociétés de gestion, associations professionnelles du marché financier régional, honorables invités, Mesdames, Messieurs. Don't worry, the last part will be in English. C'est pour moi un insigne honneur de prendre la parole en ma qualité de président du conseil d'administration de la Bourse au moment où la BRVM s'apprête à vivre dans quelques instants une journée promotionnelle de ses activités ainsi que celle du marché régional, du marché financier régional de l'UMOA. Mes premiers mots seront ceux de remerciement à vous qui avez tenu à marquer de votre présence cette journée des BRVM Investment Day, malgré vos agendas que je sais particulièrement chargés. Et tout particulièrement, Monsieur le Premier ministre, je sais que vous venez d'un très, très, très long voyage et que le jet lag ne vous a pas encore envahi. Mais personnellement, je tenais à vous remercier et à demander et vous demander de bien vouloir transmettre nos remerciements à Son Excellence le Président Yahi Boni, qui, comme chacun sait, est le Président en exercice de l'UMOA. Excellence, Charles Kofi Dibi, j'allais dire cher ami, ministre d'État, ministre des Affaires étrangères de la République de Côte d'Ivoire. Je tiens également à vous remercier de votre présence effective qui traduit une fois de plus votre attachement à tous les sujets relatifs à l'approfondissement du marché financier régional de l'UMOA. En effet, il me plaît de rappeler votre rôle déterminant dans vos anciennes fonctions de ministre de l'Économie et des Finances de Côte d'Ivoire, qui, comme je vous le disais tout à l'heure, ne peut pas vous quitter, vous l'avez pratiquement sous la peau. Chaque fois qu'il s'est agi d'initier des réformes majeures sur notre marché financier régional, soyez-en remerciés. Je vous prie de bien vouloir transmettre mes remerciements et le témoignage de ma déférente gratitude à Son Excellence, Monsieur le Président Alassane Dramane Ouattara, Président de la République de Côte d'Ivoire, ainsi qu'à l'ensemble de son gouvernement. Je remercie également l'autorité de régulation de notre marché, le Conseil régional de l'épargne publique et des marchés financiers, pour son accompagnement aux intervenants agréés du marché qui œuvrent au quotidien à son développement, aux sociétés cotées et émetteurs obligataires, à tous les autres intervenants du marché ainsi qu'aux autorités de notre UMOA pour leur confiance et le soutien à la BRVM dans sa politique de développement. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, in line with the strategy to modernize our financial system by putting in place a long-term resource mobilization mechanism and by inviting private shareholders when the stock exchange are debating over demutualization, the authorities of the union had the clear vision of the future of the stock market, which finances development while preserving the balance between its main players. The setting up of the BRVM was done in several phases, starting from the signing of the treaty constituting WAMU on November 14, 1973, until the beginning of its operations in September 16, 1998. The stock exchange complies with international standards and is also compatible to the socio-economic environment of WAMU. Like other stock exchanges around the world, BRVM encourages and mobilizes long-term savings for productive investments in the region. Its role is to ensure direct intermediation by bringing together resources, providers, and those who seek funding. Our stock exchange is a unique prototype, both regionally and internationally, in terms of its organization and architecture. And when I talk about architecture, this is the first time that an architect leads a stock market. Considered as the most complete model in terms of market integration, it is a source of inspiration for other regions in the African continent and in the world. During the last 3 years, The dynamism of the BRVM was driven by the consolidation of growth within our union and the promising development prospect that should lead to the emergence and in medium terms of many member countries. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I wish to reiterate the commitment of the board of directors of BRVM to meet major challenges that arise in our market, in particular its attractiveness for issuer and his liquidity. Indeed, the favorable macroeconomic situation of our member countries in recent years and the increasing appeasing social political climate in member countries allow us to pursue the realization of BRVM development strategy. Well, from time to time you have a little something that happens, but don't worry about that. Everything is under control. Allow me to recall the main strategy guidelines adopted by the BRVM over the last 3 years and which will continue to guide us for the next years. First, we want to facilitate market access for companies that look for funding. In addition to large companies, the objective is to include SMEs, startups, and high-growth companies which constitute a large part of our economy. In this context, the BRVM is planning to launch a dedicated board for this type of companies. With the growing demand for mining resources, mining companies are looking for capital to finance their exploration activities. In this context, one of the priorities of mining companies worldwide is to explore stock exchange through IPO. Despite the fact that no mining company is listed on the BRVM, we have a couple that I'm sure will be listed very soon. Our strategy is to explore new strategy to attract them at the BRVM. Indeed, we have many companies operating in the region. In the short term, as I said, we will target market mining companies with public participation, and in the long term, all other mining companies operating within the regions. To us, this is extremely important because, as you know, the growth of Africa has been driven by the mining sector, and for us to be able to list them in the exploration later is extremely important. And on this regard, I am sending a word to the regulator to please look at this side of the story. It's extremely important for our countries. Ladies and gentlemen, number two is to make the stock market more accessible to investors, including individuals, to increase the regional and international visibility of BRVM, to maintain the regional stock exchange to a high technological level with regular innovations. They wrote here that we wanted to be number five, and I crossed it off. We want to be number three. The third African stock exchange by 2020. And believe me, it's possible. This strategy is ambitious, of course, but I'm convinced that with everybody's involvement, and especially the support of the union's member states, we will overcome the challenges and thereby help BRVM play its role for the development of our member countries and the well-being of our people. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it is in this context of the third bullet point to increase regional and international visibility of BRVM that you are invited here in New York to participate in this major event. And for me, I was playing around in New York about 50 years back when I was a translator, to me, Mr. Chairman, it's a very, very, very big honor to be standing today at Bloomberg's and deliver a speech. Indeed, in order to attract international investors that look for growth and diversify their savings by the BRVM organized with its stockholders in the regional financial market roadshows in major financial centers in the world. Within the international investor category, The BRVM is trying to attract investment flows from the diaspora. This is very important to us. As you know, many of our folks are around. They are in New York, they're in Paris, they're everywhere. And we wish to tell them that please come and invest in the BRVM. Now that everybody knows that this is the turn of Africa after Asia, well, you'll be very well advised if you take your savings and give it to us. Well, not give it to us, but just put it right there. We will not touch it. We'll make it grow. Thank you. Within the international investor category, the BRVM, as I said, is trying to attract investors. For example, the Chinese diaspora constitutes only 2.5% of the Indonesian population, but it controls over 70% of the wealth of this country. To support this strategy, various initiatives could be implemented in our countries within the following products: diaspora bonds, mutual funds dedicated to the diaspora, investment funds dedicated to the high net worth people in the diaspora, issuance of global deposit notes, GDN, etc., etc. And here also, Mr. Chairman, I know that your support would be greatly appreciated. Here we are in New York today for another edition of the BRVM Investment Days. Thus, after Paris, and I have to highlight that in Paris we had the support of the Prime Minister, who is sitting here. At the time he was not Prime Minister, of course, but he was still more than interested in the evolution of our stock exchange. London, April 28, 2015. I wish to this end to thank the American authorities and those of the City of New York for facilitating the organization of this event, and express to the New York Stock Exchange my gratitude for its role supporting us. Finally, express my gratitude to Bloomberg Group, who agreed to receive us in these premises to hold BRVM Days today, 2015 in New York. This special attention of Bloomberg Group to us does not surprise us, given the good relation that maintained for many years between our institutions that we maintain. Indeed, BRVM market data and information are available in real time in Bloomberg terminals. Well, we know that we have to improve it, but we know that you've been helping us, and my director general is here, and I know that we'll be doing everything in the books to meet the standards. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, let me conclude my speech by reiterating my sincere thanks to all for your participation, while wishing to take advantage of this important moment, which we all be part of. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Goudiaby. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Salwa Chakri, Head of Market Structure Strategy for Bloomberg, covering Middle East and Africa. I would like to now welcome our next speaker, the Prime Minister of Benin. He is representing His Excellency Thomas Boni Yayi, President of the Republic of Benin. He's one of the most respected economists for the region, with a very optimistic vision on the development of the continent. So, ladies and gentlemen, a warm welcome for His Excellency, Mr. Lionel Zinsser.
Mr. Minister of State of Ivory Coast, in charge of foreign affairs, and who has inspired us during the 10 years as Minister of Finance of the largest country in the West African Union zone. Mr. President, Mr. Director General, Mr. Executive Chairman of the Bloomberg Company, and all the organizers, distinguished guests, and distinguished investors. As President Goudiaby said, I'm here on behalf of the President of the WAEMU, the West African Economic and Monetary Union, Thomas Yayiboni, who is working a bit on Burkina, one of our sister countries today. So he asked me, seeing that the crisis was to be resolved, but that it needed a bit of time, he asked me to be here. But I'm also here as a friend of the BRVM, and I was so pleased as an investor. So I was in the other side of the room as an investor running until last June a private equity fund, the largest French private equity fund, PAI. I was your guest in the first investment day in Paris. So I come here officially, but I also come here as a very loyal friend of the Bourse des Valeurs. I think in opening this day, I would like to share with you two or three very simple ideas. One is that the West African Monetary Zone was missing something when we had no real serious professional stock exchange. You cannot conceive development without a proper financial framework, able to consolidate, incentivize savings, create a pool of savings, and put this pool of resources to working for development. So it has been a key element of the strengthening of the region, this institution, this common institution as a financial market. The West African Union is something which is one of the best kept secrets of Africa. It's one of the best managed part of Africa in terms of growth and financial stability. This is not necessarily known, maybe because sometimes we speak too much in French in conferences, I don't know. That's why today we elected to speak a bit in English. I'm sorry for my English, but I think we have to do it. We are something like 100 million. We have something like a GDP of $100 billion in dollars. But we are a zone, a part of the world, where we execute our budgets on a very balanced way. We have norms of convergence, and in effect, our economic policies and financial policies really converge. So we have a norm of budget and limits on the public sector borrowing requirements, very strict, and we are very disciplined. It's 3%, but unlike Europe a few years ago, we stick to it. So it is, we are the only part of the world complying with the Maastricht objectives. We have a very disciplined and converging economic policy. We have economies from Senegal to Benin which are not that heterogeneous. Yes, there is a difference in between our big brother Ivory Coast compared to smaller countries, but the fact is that we are not focused only on raw materials. We are economies with a very important tertiary sector, something that people also usually ignore. We are economies more and more dedicated to the tertiary sector, to service industries. The most important today in our economies is about trade, logistics, telecom, financial services. It is not what people think a natural resource-based economy. And this, in Africa, in sub-Saharan Africa, is a specificity of our zone. So we are a diversified economy. Yes, agriculture is absolutely key in terms of natural resources, and essentially on the social ground, because our active population is sort of 50% dedicated to agriculture and works in agriculture. That is true. But the contribution to our GDP is everywhere below one third, when the service industry is the number one. And another thing that people do not necessarily know about us is the fact that the manufacturing industry and the construction, civil works, bâtiment travaux publics, and transforming manufacturing industries are now 20% of our GDP. So we are on the way of transforming, elaborating, putting value added in our natural resources or agricultural resources. Sometimes I smile a bit because you may have noticed that I'm both a French citizen of the private sector and a Benin citizen involved in government. So when I read Africa has no manufacturing industry, especially sub-Saharan Africa has no manufacturing industry, I look at the national accounts of Benin, where the secondary sector is 20% of GDP. Then I compare with France, where manufacturing industry is 13% of the GDP. So don't go too quickly in thinking that our economies have not started to add value and work for what? Work for the consumers, because consumption is everywhere in our zone, north of 70% of the GDP. So obviously, it is a sort of paradise for consumer goods, and it's the number one, with the food and drink industries being number one within the consumer industries, but it is a paradise for consumer industries. And building materials is also a very important part of our industry. It's just because our industries are not yet, in many cases, part of the value chain of the world's most advanced products. That you will find more north of Africa. If you want to find parts of the Airbus cockpits, or if you want to see some complex value chain of advanced mechanics and so on. Yes, it is more the north of Africa and the very south of Africa. Sub-Saharan Africa is at a very important stage of manufacturing industry, which is responding to the real needs of the population. And with our demographic growth across the zone of 3.5% yearly growth, consumer goods and everything which is related to urban development is obviously the number one part of our manufacturing industry. But we are on the way of expanding that. It's not necessarily seen very easily, because part of it is informal. And yes, we have an informal sector, which is the number one contributor to employment. So our labor market is very specific, because there is a dual labor market. And in my country, 80% of job creation, is done by the informal sector. But the informal sector is something complex. And within the informal sector, you start to have some serious firms with access to credit, access to technology. So informal sector is a concept that we have to carefully use. But the fact is that part of this manufacturing, light manufacturing, done by SMEs, is done in the informal sector. It's one of the reasons why it's not so visible. Nevertheless, we have significant middle-sized and large firms, and they are the candidates for our BRVM, and they, in their journey from SMEs in the informal sector to becoming large companies in the formal sector, they will meet the BRVM on the road. So we are something which is, in terms of the way the policy making today is dedicated to private sector facilitation, to improving the doing business environment, in enforcing the rule of law. We are a part of Africa which has a disciplined policy making and a remarkable financial stability. In our zone, unlike some of our sister countries, inflation is below 3%. In my country, it's in between 0 and 1. So inflation is mastered. Public deficit in last year for us was 1%, again below 3 for the zone, and growth is everywhere above 5% in volume terms. And in the major country in our zone, Ivory Coast, we have a quasi double-digit growth since now 4 years. So all that creates a very specific, quite safe place for investment and profit in Africa. That's what we are, and what not necessarily everybody knows we are. But why is a financial modern market is so essential? We used to have a situation 20, 15 years ago, which was adverse to growth. And we were in the 80s and the 90s in a level of economic growth which was below our demographic growth. So we were on the way to becoming poorer and poorer in two very, very difficult decades. But starting mid-90s, something happened which is very important, and far more important in a sense than the price of raw materials going up, which is a financial revolution. We used to have huge problems of financing our economies. In front of our needs for infrastructure, needs for producing public goods, health, education, security, all that, with immense needs, we had the worst difficulties to finance our economies. We had a very orthodox, quite conservative monetary policy. Today, we have a proactive monetary policy, with regulators acting in favor of the private sector, financing economy, supporting the stock exchange. So in terms of our monetary framework today, we have a sort of unlimited access to liquidity for the banking sector, which is totally new, and which is clearly a dedicated policy of the governments and translated and executed by the central bank, the BCEAO. It's very, very important, this supply of liquidity. Second, we had a non-competitive banking system with huge long-term stable resources and no form of modern credit. A banking system dedicated to financing agriculture cycle and not at all the needs of corporates and the needs of investments. So we were the only part of the world where we were converting stable resources in short-term assets, which was destroying value. This has dramatically changed. Competition is everywhere. You may have noticed that banks in our region are from the region, from abroad, from Morocco, from South Africa, from Nigeria, from everywhere. And in terms of quality of services, and in terms of providing credit with the necessary support of the central bank, to the corporate, it's like day and night. It has dramatically changed. Because we have a stock exchange which is efficient, The governments are not anymore financed like they used to be 10 years ago. Today, we have a bond market. We have a sovereign bond market in our own currency. Our currency, which has a peg with euro, the franc CFA, has now a deep and efficient market. It is the BRVM. We are able to be oversubscribed in each and every of our issuing of bonds. We, this month in Benin, issued a new bond. We were disappointed because we were only oversubscribed by sort of 70%. Normally we do far better, far better. And Ivory Coast, I have to pay tribute, is always far more oversubscribed than we are. So we have to make more roadshows for Benin. There is no circumstance where we had, as governments, scarcity of financing. And today we use all the maturities. So we are able to issue bonds 5 years, 3 years, 2 years, 1 year. We have all the panoply of sovereign financial instruments on our domestic market in our currency. It's a dramatic change. 10 years ago, we were to go to only public aid, budgetary aid for the treasuries. We had to go to the central bank with very tight limits. Today, because we have a very low level of indebtedness, in Benin, we are at 30% of GDP in terms of sovereign indebtedness. So, again, part of the world where it's the best mastered. Then we have this deep and efficient market, which means all the infrastructure of professionals. BRVM is a professional market with all the professionals, the rating agencies, the treasury agency common to the governments, and all the professions around the market. This was absolutely absent in terms of a way to finance our economies 10 years ago. So it is now a very structured market. We start to have ways to finance real estate. When you have 3.5% growth in your demographics, it means you have 5 to 7% growth in urban development. You have to finance that. And that means long-term resources. We were unable, can you imagine that? We were in such a situation, we were unable to match long-term liabilities with long-term assets. We were unable to finance anything like our urban development. Today we have a market. We are able to match the asset classes. We need real estate financing, and this, and I have to pay tribute also to the BOAD and to the president of BOAD and what BOAD is doing in this respect in terms of the marché hypothécaire. But the real estate specialized instruments are absolutely key for our development. It means we have the proper environments in terms of savings. Today, our insurance companies, life and damage insurance, are very active on our market, which means long-term, sort of search for long-term maturities and long-term returns. And we can provide them with that. We have pension funds. We will, I'm sure, given all the incentives that the African Development Bank is developing today, we will develop tomorrow sovereign funds. We need long-term investors on our market. But insurance, we are at the beginning, and it's very easy to understand, of a boom, a sort of historical boom of insurance companies. You see that everywhere in our zone. It is one of the healthiest providers of savings for the BRVM. Because clearly, when you have a middle class growing, when you have a 5 to 9% GDP growth, when you have such a youth, You are building a market for life insurance, which will be second to none, or sort of Asian-like, 20 years ago, style of life insurance market. And you go even quicker for damage and reinsurance. So that, again, you would never have said in New York that 10 years ago. It's now. It is starting now. It is developing now. And it is not only us. It's true of Kenya. It's true of Nigeria. It's true of Ghana. It's true of Sierra Leone and so on. It is a continental phenomenon. Long-term pools of savings through pension funds, insurance companies. And we have private equity. I finish by private equity just not to look like being biased, having run a private equity firm for the last 8 years. Private equity is now everywhere in Africa, be it global firms or local firms, be it large funds or small funds dedicated to SMEs, be it specialized funds for agriculture, infrastructures and energy. And we have created something which is an hybrid of sovereign fund and private equity fund, which is called Africa 50, which has been sponsored by the African Development Bank and which is starting its operations with contributions by the governments, and which is half a sovereign fund because the state contributions have created the fund, half an infrastructure private equity fund, with all the professional, privately minded ways of managing. Another essential component in the environment of our stock exchange market. So we have the private equity. And why is the private equity important? Not because it is an alternative investment to the bank, to the bourse, to the stock exchange, but because it's an absolutely major player. Because when you enter in a business, you need to exit from this business. And you need a structured market. You need an IPO market. You need to be able to issue bonds on this market. And private equity, which is already an important player in South Africa, in East Africa, in Nigeria, starts to be a player in our Bourse Régionale des Valeurs. Because it used to be an Anglo-Saxon strange capitalist instrument. It's now Pan-African. So private equity will be everywhere and an important actor, because we need players on this market, people wanting to enter and wanting to exit. And we will have that. So don't think that in this match, long-term assets, long-term liabilities, financing modern economies instead of financing colonial memories. We have financed colonial memories of how do you finance a peanuts campaign or a cocoa campaign or a cotton campaign using your credit for 3 months. I mean, we have financed our economies that way from the 60s, our independence, to the 80s. We went to a major crisis. Since the beginning of the 2000s, and the BRVM is the symbol and the tool, we are financing real economies. That's why we have real growth. 15 years of growth above 15%. We have been resilient to 2008 and 2009. Remaining in a growth mode, 3%. We have been resilient to the euro crisis. Europe is our number one client, supplier, investor, and the source of remittances of the diaspora, evoked by the president. Europe went in recession, second half of 2011 until second half of 2013. We accelerated. We went up. Our growth during those recession years has been 4, 5, 6%. We are decoupled from the European market because our growth is endogenous. It's very important for you to understand that. We are not coupled with the European economies, even if they are the number one altogether, if you take the whole of the Eurozone, the number one suppliers and clients. So we have been very resilient. If we had not had this financial revolution, we would remain, we would be exactly in the same situation than in the 80s. We would be at 2-3%, becoming poorer every day. It's maybe because I'm, by profession, a financier, that I consider that finance is useful, which is absolutely not fashionable nowadays. Finance is essential to the development. Here in the United States, all the financial assets are four times, a bit more than four times the GDP. In our continent and our zone, our continent is one time the GDP, not four times. And in our zone, it's half. So half the African level. So we have a future, which is to develop financial instruments, financial asset classes, all asset classes. What I was just wanting to say in opening your discussions is we have now in place, some in infancy, other already mature, all the asset classes for investors like yours to consider this market as a serious one and for us to be able to guarantee a sustainable growth properly financed. Je vous remercie.
Thank you. That was a very insightful opening remark. So I would like to now welcome Mr. Charles Koffi Dibi, Minister of State and Foreign Affairs of Côte d'Ivoire. He served as a finance minister of Côte d'Ivoire for 10 years. During that time, he chaired the Council of Ministers of Finance of the West African Economic and Monetary Union. Mr. Dibi is representing His Excellency Daniel Cablan Ducamp, Prime Minister of Côte d'Ivoire. Please welcome Mr. Dibi.
Merci beaucoup. Monsieur le Premier ministre du Bénin, je voudrais avouer que, après votre passage, il nous est difficile de nous exprimer, mais parce que vous faites la fierté de l'Afrique, et tout particulièrement la nôtre, dans notre sous-région. Parce qu'aujourd'hui, Monsieur le Premier ministre, vous allez faire en sorte que la gouvernance publique puisse bénéficier de votre grande expérience au niveau du secteur privé. Je vous le disais, nous autres, nous sommes suffisamment âgés, donc nous ne pourrons pas suivre la nouvelle dynamique. Mais les jeunes gens qui ont entre 30 et 40 ans, qui sont dans nos administrations aujourd'hui, vous êtes un bon modèle et nous savons qu'avec avec vous et ceux-là qui vont certainement suivre et accompagner tout le processus, alors notre administration va encore plus se moderniser et se dynamiser. Merci, Monsieur le Premier ministre. Monsieur le Président de Bloomberg, merci de nous inviter aujourd'hui. Monsieur le Président de la BRVM, cher aîné, Atepa, il vous a fallu un coup de fil pour que je sois là. Je voudrais saluer également toutes les entreprises qui sont ici présentes et saluer ma sœur, Madame la ministre Studer, avec qui j'ai eu beaucoup de plaisir à travailler, saluer l'ensemble des ambassadeurs et vous dire que je représente effectivement Monsieur le Premier ministre Daniel Cablan Ducamp, qui est en même temps ministre du Budget et de l'Économie empêché et qui m'a chargé de vous transmettre son adresse qui se décline comme suite. Je voudrais, au nom du gouvernement et du peuple ivoirien, vous exprimer toute la joie que j'éprouve à être dans cette prestigieuse cité de New York, important pôle commercial, industriel et financier à l'échelle mondiale. Je saisis cette occasion pour adresser mes remerciements aux hautes personnalités issues des milieux d'affaires ici présents qui nous font l'honneur de leur présence distinguée à cette rencontre d'échange. L'initiative de cette rencontre témoigne de l'engagement et de la ferme détermination de mon gouvernement à accompagner la Bourse régionale des valeurs immobilières pour son plein épanouissement. Et je voudrais justement rappeler certains points très importants dont a parlé M. le Premier ministre ici présent. La zone UMOA est l'une des meilleures réussites d'intégration qui existent au monde. Elle date de plus de 20 ans. 8 pays décident d'avoir une monnaie commune. Elle a commencé d'abord par une union monétaire ouest-africaine. Et par la suite, on l'a étendue à une union économique et faire en sorte de déterminer des critères de convergence pour que 8 pays forment une seule économie, et c'est ce qu'on appelle la 9e économie, qui est l'économie stable. Et pour cela, il a fallu en même temps créer les instruments qui pouvaient permettre de rendre cette économie dynamique et la rendre beaucoup stable. Tout à l'heure, on va vous parler des différents critères de convergence qui gouvernent justement la gestion de cette économie et avec une monnaie commune, avec une banque centrale unique. Dans la zone UMOA, nous n'avons pas d'inflation qui soit d'origine monétaire. Elle est juste lorsque l'économie réelle a des difficultés, par exemple en ce qui concerne l'agriculture, lorsque les pluies se font rares et qu'en ce moment les céréales se font rares, c'est en ce moment-là que nous avons quelques éléments qui font que l'inflation s'augmente. Et tout à l'heure, le Premier ministre le disait, dans notre zone, toute l'inflation ne dépasse pas plus de 2%. Et ce qui est d'ailleurs très bien géré, et on a une gestion monétaire assez stricte. Nous sommes arrimés à l'euro, donc les problèmes de change par rapport aux autres pays sont assez bien gérés. Et nous avons chez nous ce qui est, dans le critère de convergence, nous avons une notion importante qui est la solidarité. Ce qui fait que, en ce qui concerne la gestion des réserves, le pays n'est pas obligé d'avoir le niveau de réserve qui lui permette de faire son commerce. Puisqu'il s'agit d'une réserve qui est mise ensemble, tout le monde tire ensemble, quel que soit celui qui apporte le plus. Et je comprends maintenant pourquoi est-ce que le Premier ministre a insisté sur tout cet ensemble-là pour parler de notre instrument commun qui est la Bourse régionale des valeurs immobilières. Si vous avez remarqué, la Bourse régionale des valeurs immobilières, pendant près de 10 ans, a connu une période très atone. Elle n'a pas été très dynamique. Et je vais vous dire pourquoi. C'est parce que le pays le plus important en matière de masse monétaire, qui représente 40% de la masse monétaire de l'Union, était en crise, et c'est la Côte d'Ivoire. Qu'est-ce qui s'est passé depuis que le président de la République, son Excellence Alassane Ouattara, a pris les rênes du pays? Dès la fin de la crise socio-politique que notre pays a connu, le gouvernement ivoirien a élaboré le plan national de développement 2012-2015 qui vise la construction d'une nouvelle ère, une nouvelle prospérité économique pour le bonheur de la population. Mais ce plan se décline en 3 éléments essentiels: paix et sécurité, réconciliation nationale et cohésion sociale, reconstruction et relance économique. Je vous en parle parce que c'est la Côte d'Ivoire qui abrite la BRVM et c'est la croissance de la Côte d'Ivoire qui tire vers le haut l'ensemble de la croissance de notre zone UMOA. Lorsque la Côte d'Ivoire était en difficulté, que notre croissance oscillait entre 1,05 - -2 à 3%, la zone UMOA avait une croissance moyenne de 3%, et tout à l'heure, le Premier ministre l'a rappelé. Bien entendu, on est tous d'accord qu'aucun développement durable n'étant possible sans la paix et la stabilité. Le gouvernement ivoirien a fait la question de la sécurité une priorité à travers les réformes d'envergure pour le retour de la paix sur l'ensemble du territoire national. Ainsi, l'indice de sécurité qui était de 3,8 points en janvier 2012 est passé à 1,18 en 2015, favorisant ainsi le retour à la confiance en notre pays et partant le retour de nombreuses organisations internationales à leur siège à Abidjan. Il s'agit notamment de la Banque africaine de développement, du Bureau national de l'UNESCO et bientôt du Bureau régional de l'Organisation internationale du travail. S'agissant de la réconciliation nationale, les efforts de la Commission Dialogue, Vérité et Réconciliation et la mise sur pied d'un cadre permanent de dialogue politique avec l'opposition ont contribué à une décrispation et au renforcement du processus de normalisation du climat sociopolitique, qui devra permettre, bien entendu, d'assurer à fin octobre 2015, c'est-à-dire dans quelques mois, des élections apaisées, crédibles, inclusives et transparentes pour notre pays. Cela viendra consolider la paix et la stabilité dans notre pays pour encore plusieurs années à venir. S'agissant enfin de la relance économique, le gouvernement ivoirien a clairement affiché sa volonté de faire du secteur privé, et cela selon le thème très précis du président de la République, le levier de la croissance économique. Mesdames et messieurs, notre présence ici nous permet justement d'élaborer quelques aspects de ce qui a été fait pour avoir une croissance forte que nous espérons durable. Le PND 2012-2015 qui s'achève est celui portant sur le cycle de 2016 à 2020 retiennent une part toujours croissante de la contribution du secteur privé dans le volume global des investissements à travers certaines conventions et des conventions plus importantes de partenariats publics et privés, et ainsi que des BOT qui offrent plus d'opportunités aux hommes d'affaires. À cet effet, mon gouvernement a entrepris des réformes structurelles et sectorielles qui ont amélioré le climat des affaires, permettant au secteur privé de jouer pleinement son rôle dans l'atteinte des objectifs sociaux et économiques du plan national de développement. Il s'agit, entre autres, de l'ouverture d'un guichet unique pour faciliter le processus de création d'entreprises qui s'opère aujourd'hui en 24 heures. Ce qui se faisait en un an a été ramené à 24 heures. Un guichet unique pour créer une entreprise aujourd'hui en Côte d'Ivoire. La création d'un tribunal de commerce, améliorant ainsi l'environnement judiciaire à travers la sécurisation des investissements et la célérité du règlement des litiges commerciaux. Le tribunal du commerce n'existait pas auparavant. Il a été mis en place sur instruction ferme du président de la République. L'adoption de nouveaux codes d'investissement et de nouveaux codes de milieu du minier des plus attractifs qui garantissent la rentabilité des investissements. Quels sont les résultats de ces réformes en si peu de temps? Le classement de la Côte d'Ivoire deux années successives dans les top des 10 des pays les plus réformateurs au monde selon les rapports de Doing Business, rapport 2014 et 2015. Une croissance économique soutenue, mais surtout une croissance économique étonnante. Lorsque la Côte d'Ivoire achevait sa crise en 2011, nous étions en récession de moins 4,7%. En 2012, nous sommes passés à une croissance de 9,8%. Selon nous, nos estimations, nous étions à 10%, mais le Fonds monétaire a été un peu trop exigeant, ils nous ont retiré 0,2%. Nous avons accepté, c'est pas grave. En 2013, nous sommes à 9%, et en 2014, nous estimons être à 9,1%, c'est-à-dire maintenir cette croissance-là et aller dans une croissance à deux chiffres. La notation de B1 et B de la Côte d'Ivoire, respectivement par les agences Moody's et Fitch Ratings, avec des perspectives positives. la preuve que la Côte d'Ivoire a retrouvé toute sa crédibilité, nous sommes allés sur le marché des eurobonds en 2014 pour un objectif de 500 millions de dollars avec un taux de réalisation de 750 millions de dollars en levée de fonds sur les marchés internationaux en février 2015. Je voulais rappeler que le taux d'inflation est de 2,2%. Nous sommes en dessous des normes, excusez-moi, communautaires. Nous avons une croissance démographique de 2,6% et une croissance de 9%, ce qui veut dire que linéairement, chaque Ivoirien s'enrichit chaque année. Et nous avons également, comme je le disais tout à l'heure, que notre masse monétaire dans l'Union, nous avons 40% de la masse monétaire. Et notre déficit est d'environ 3% de notre PIB. Et vous remarquez que notre niveau d'endettement est en dessous de 40% de notre PIB. Mais je voudrais rappeler que la Côte d'Ivoire a bénéficié en 2012 de l'initiative PPTE pour l'annulation de sa dette bilatérale et multilatérale. À l'époque, notre endettement était de près de 75% de notre PIB. Mais dès que nous avons atteint le point d'achèvement et que les annulations ont été faites, nous sommes retombés à 20%. Aujourd'hui, avec l'ensemble des travaux qui se réalisent, la Côte d'Ivoire est à 35% globalement au niveau de son endettement. Vous constatez vous-même que les finances publiques sont gérées et bien gérées et que l'ensemble des indicateurs macroéconomiques sont ouverts. Alors, des personnes avisées disent « Côte d'Ivoire is back ». Ces acquis m'autorisent également à partager avec vous la conviction que c'est bien le moment pour les hommes d'affaires de venir en Côte d'Ivoire et investir parce que la zone UEMOA demeure très dynamique et comme le disait tout à l'heure Monsieur le Premier ministre, notre bourse régionale des valeurs mobilières est un instrument aujourd'hui très dynamique et crédible. Je m'en vais vous dire que le marché primaire est très animé par les États. Dans la zone UEMOA, depuis près de 15 ans, nous n'avons plus eu recours au financement monétaire de la Banque centrale. Il a été décidé qu'à l'époque, chaque début d'année, la Banque centrale faisait une avance de trésorerie aux États qui se calculait sur le dixième des ressources, des recettes propres collectées l'année d'avant. Et cela permettait aux États, en attendant d'avoir la trésorerie propre, de pouvoir assurer leur fonctionnement. Mais depuis 15 ans, cette facilité a été arrêtée. Il a été demandé aux États d'aller animer le marché des titres. Et c'est la BRVM, justement, avec le Conseil régional de l'épargne, qui se charge, justement, d'encadrer cela. À l'époque, nous sommes un peu pleins de la BRVM parce que nous disions que le marché primaire était suffisamment animé, mais que le marché secondaire ne l'était pas suffisamment. Aujourd'hui, c'est chose faite. La Banque centrale admet ses titres en refinancement, ce qui encourage également tous les souscripteurs, et cela donne beaucoup plus de profondeur à ces marchés-là. Et cela, moi, j'ai dit, je félicite les responsables de la BRVM. On en a souvent parlé, non? Vous m'avez dit que ça allait être corrigé. Ben, bravo. Mesdames et messieurs, la Côte d'Ivoire a en effet retrouvé son rang de leader et de locomotive économique et financière de la sous-région. Et cela, il fallait le comprendre. Le pays a connu 10 ans de crise. Et ce pays-là, qui est la locomotive d'une sous-région qui a 10 ans de crise, 10 ans de récession, ne pouvait pas permettre de donner la crédibilité qu'il fallait à cet instrument important pour capter l'épargne et redistribuer cette épargne pour le financement de l'économie qui est la BRVM. Aujourd'hui, la Côte d'Ivoire est en paix. Aujourd'hui, la gouvernance de la Côte d'Ivoire est clairement assurée. Aujourd'hui, l'environnement dans lequel évolue la BRVM est un environnement crédible. Moi, je peux vous dire, on peut faire confiance à notre bourse régionale des valeurs immobilières. Merci de votre attention.
Merci infiniment, Monsieur Diby. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now time for a coffee networking break. So please do make your way outside, help yourself with some refreshment. If I may just ask you to be back in about 15 minutes for the roundtable. Thank you.